lecture number 16, he'll continue with biological macromolecules, and we'll talk in particular about carbohydrates. In living organisms, carbohydrates can be utilized for a number of different processes. For example, energy storage, one very important one. These energetically rich organic molecules can be metabolized, and the energy that is gained out of them can be utilized for other metabolic processes within living cells. Another function of carbohydrates can be cell signaling. In this case here, carbohydrates can be associated with cell membranes, with the lipids, or with the proteins that are incorporated into cell membranes, and act as cell surface markers. Carbohydrates also act as structural elements. For example, arthropods, the chitin in arthropods, are carbohydrates. And they can be formidable protection for those animals. If you just think about a lobster and how hard it is to crack the exoskeleton of a lobster, you get a feeling for how tough these exoskeletons can really be. Then they also, of course, give those animals their shape and structure and form, and allow them to walk and to function the way they have to function. We also talked about the cell walls and fungi that consist out of chitin. Or another form of carbohydrates that is incorporated in cell walls of plants is the cellulose, which, as you know from plants, can also be fairly sturdy and give cells their shape and sturdiness. If we look at the chemical formula of carbohydrates, they are made up out of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, at a ratio of 1:2:1. With other words, for each carbon, there's two hydrogens and one oxygen. In the case of glucose, which is a 6-carbon sugar, we have the chemical formula of C6H12O6. And here we have this molecule, and as you can see, it can exist in two stages. It can either exist as a linear molecule, or it can exist in form of a ring structure. And it can actually differ between those two. It can either form from a circular structure, from a ring structure, into a linear structure, or it can go back into a ring structure. When they are in aqueous solution, the ring structure is usually preferred. And what happens here is that in this case of the glucose, we have the hydrogen on this 5th carbon atom here react with the oxygen on this carbonyl group up here, which is an aldehyde group in this case, and form this ring. And depending on whether this closure takes place on one side of this carbon or on the other side of this carbon, we can either have an alpha linkage or we can have a beta linkage. And these are called either an alpha anomer or a beta anomer. And this is important because enzymes that are very specific for the molecules that they cleave cannot cleave either linkage, so they cannot cleave both linkages. Sugars have isomers of each other. So if you look at this one here, we have glucose, galactose, and fructose, and all of them consist out of the same chemical formula, namely C6H12O6. However, they are different sugars because they have different isomers. And they can be either structural isomers or they can be stereoisomers. In this case here of fructose and glucose, we have a structural isomer. And what you see here is that our carbonyl group, in this case here, is in form of a keto group, where we have the 2nd carbon contains an oxygen. In this case of glucose, our carbonyl group is an aldehyde group that is here on the 1st carbon atom. In the case of the stereoisomers, and here's the example of glucose and galactose, we depending on the way how the carbonyl group is formed, we either have the aldehyde group or we have a keto group. We talk about aldoses or we talk about ketosis. Furthermore, sugars can consist out of more than or out of different numbers of carbon atoms. They are the ones that consist out of 3, out of 4, 5 or 6 carbon atoms, and accordingly they are called triose, tetrose, pentose, and hexose. And as you might have guessed, when there's the syllabus "-ose", at the end of the word, then this usually refers to a sugar. It's a chemical syllabus that is attached to a name for a sugar. So with other words, depending on our carbonyl group, we either have aldoses or ketoses that are either trioses, tetroses, pentoses, or hexoses. So if I tell you that it's a triose aldose, you know that it has 3 carbons and then it has an aldehyde group rather than a keto group. The way how those molecules are transported and stored is in different ways. So storage forms are usually the polysaccharides, so the polymerized monosaccharides. Whereas for transport of these molecules, so if there's an emergency and energy needs to be accessed and utilized, then we have the monosaccharides and the disaccharides that are usually transported to the cells, transported into the cells, and then metabolized within the cells. The monosaccharides are the ones that usually get metabolized. The dimers, disaccharides, are usually the ones that are mainly in for transport. These usually need to be cleaved in order to get the monosaccharides for the utilization of the energy for the metabolism of them. There are different storage forms of sugars in different organisms. In animal cells, sugars are stored in form of glycogen. And glycogen, as you can see here, is a very highly branched polymolecule. And you can see that all of those monomers here are polymerized to this big macromolecule. This polymerization of those monomers is all through alpha-1-4 linkages. And this is important because the enzymes that we have in our cells to cleave those macromolecules into the individual disaccharides or monosaccharides are only able to cleave those alpha-1-4 linkages. The average glycogen stores in humans last for about only 1 day. So these are not really very long-term storages. So if you are going on a big expedition and you don't have a lot of food, you, for the first day of your expedition, you live on your glycogen resources, and after that your body switches to fat metabolism. This is more the long-term storage within the organisms, and fat on average lasts for about a month. Here in this image you see those little glycogen granules within cells that can be metabolized if they are needed for the utilization of energy. Plants store energy in form of starch, carbohydrates in form of starch. And as you can see here, starch can also be a branched molecule and is also polymerized through the alpha-1-4 linkages. With other words, we can metabolize starch as well and get access to those energetically rich molecules, the energy that is stored within those molecules and metabolize them. For example, you can eat potatoes. Plants use the starch. If you look at a potato, take this example of a potato. If you put a potato in the ground and as a sapling formed within this organism for the potato plant to produce its own energy. Until then, it relies solely on the energy that is stored within this potato in form of starch. And this starch is metabolized in order to drive all of those developmental processes within the potato plant, this potato sapling. And here you can see an electron micrograph of this chloroplast that has starch granules within them that are formed through photosynthesis. The cell wall of plants consists out of this linear cellulose. So this is not branched, it's a linear molecule. And unlike the glycogen and the starch that we've talked about that is linked through the alpha 1-4 linkages, these molecules now have beta 1-4 linkages. And our enzymes are not able to cleave those linkages. If you look at those molecules, they are otherwise have the same chemical formula. With other words, the cellulose has as much energy in it as the starch in this case here. However, we cannot metabolize it, we cannot cleave it, and don't have access to this energy because we don't have the enzymes to cleave it. For this reason, plant material doesn't have as many calories for us as we cannot access this energy, but it has a lot of energy for cows. Cows themselves don't synthesize this enzyme either. However, they have a symbiotic relationship with bacteria who can cleave the cellulose. So they are microbes that have the ability to digest the cellulose and form the monomers, and cows can, for that reason, then utilize the energy that is stored within cellulose. So finally, desaccharides are two of those monomers, monosaccharides that are linked together through the dehydration reaction. And different sugars consist out of different monomers. So sucrose, for example, which is our normal table sugar, consists out of glucose and fructose. And the enzyme that is able to cleave this dimer is the sucrase. Then lactose, which is milk sugar, consists out of galactose and glucose. And lactase would be the specific enzyme that cleaves this dimer. So here you can see that there are a number of different sugars, and they are different sugars because they consist out of different monomers that form dimers, and there are different enzymes that are important for the cleavage of these sugars. The expression of these enzymes that cleave those sugars is limited to the areas where those sugars are needed and metabolized in order to avoid the inappropriate metabolism of those sugars in areas where the energy cannot be utilized and not be properly stored in form, for example, of ATP, and that can be utilized for cells. So there are a number of protective mechanisms in which organisms ensure that the energy resource is really used where it is needed. So this is all that I wanted to discuss with regard